In this screencast, we're going to work through a pipe flow example in which, similar to another screencast where we had to calculate the diameter of the pipe given certain flow characteristics, here we have to calculate the flow rate Q for our piping network. So let's take a look at this schematic so we can figure out what's going on. We have water flowing from our city supply network into our house at 25 psi gauge pressure. And we know it leaves a faucet in the second floor of the house, so right away we could show that P2 is equal to 0 PSIG, since it's open atmosphere. So we're given some information in terms of the length and height of this pipe network, as well as some of the connections that make up this system. Now, for those of you with some experience solving these types of problems, you're right away thinking this is going to be an iterative approach, and you're right. Because we have no known velocity, and we are trying to determine the volumetric flow rate, this is going to be a solution that is reliant on both calculating the Reynolds number as well as the losses associated with the pipe system. And this is all based on a velocity. So since we don't have a velocity, it is going to be an iterative approach. So the first thing I like to do is convert all the values to the same unit system and collect any information we may need to help us along the way, like the properties of the fluid. So we have water coming into our system, and doing a quick Google search for, you know, city water lines, we're going to assume this is about 60 degrees Fahrenheit. And so we're going to want the density of the water as well as the viscosity of the water to do our calculations. And I'm going to work in English units since we're starting with the pressure in PSI. We're looking for Q. This is the one thing we want, and we want it in gallons per minute. So we're also told about some of the connections, but we'll get there when we start writing out our losses. In determining our losses for the system, the velocity, as we mentioned, does play a large role, and we don't have that. And that doesn't allow us to also determine whether it's not laminar or turbulent flow, which will help us to determine the major frictional losses in the pipe system. So we need to at least set up our equations so that we could get to a point where we're just plugging in values and then checking to make sure that they match. So the first place in terms of determining if it's laminar or turbulent flow and characterizing the type of flow that we have in our system is using Reynolds number. So we have the density, the diameter, and the viscosity, so I could rewrite the Reynolds number in terms of V. When I do this, I get 6,906 times V. So now we have a starting point to determine a Reynolds number, and you'll see where that's going to come into play. So when we approach these types of problems, we start with an overall energy balance between the two points. And that energy balance is going to have the following form. It looks like the Bernoulli equation, but it isn't because we're accounting for both major and minor losses. So we account for the pressure term, the kinetic term, the potential energy term, and lastly, these loss terms. So this almost becomes plug and chug, but again, we don't have velocity, so we want to simplify this equation as much as possible and get it down to that being the only variable left. So I like writing out the terms and putting the values in and then crossing out what we know so that we at least have a good approach to solving the problem. So P1 was given to us as 25 PSIG. P2, since it's open to atmosphere, is just zero. Now our alpha, both alpha 1 and alpha 2, is our kinetic energy parameter for our flow. Now, when we have turbulent flow, this is approximately 1. So we're going to assume that that's 1 so that we don't have to worry about it. And if we find later that our flow isn't turbulent, then we should come back and reevaluate this equation. We know our density. We don't know our velocity. We could use the gravitational constant. And then we need to look at our elevation. If we look at our schematic, we could say that point 1, the elevation is equal to 0. As we move up the system, we go up 5 and 10 feet. So our elevation at point 2 is going to be 15 feet. Now we got a couple other things. So F here, our major loss term, has F, the frictional factor. And that's something that is going to be based on the velocity of our fluid and that Reynolds number that we just calculated in terms of velocity. So we don't have that. But based on our schematic, we can calculate L. We know D. We know rho. Now looking at our minor losses, we could look up the minor loss coefficients, KL, for each of the connections and bins in our system. So we're going to say we have that. We'll write that out in a second. So now we have everything down to velocity and this friction factor, F. So let's go determine the length of our pipe network. So we have a total of 45 feet of pipe. We also know the diameter as 0.0833 feet. The last thing we said we would calculate is our loss coefficients. So let's go take a look at our schematic and figure out what we need to look up. So we have threaded elbows, and we have 4 elbows for our pipe system. So we're going to have to look up the loss coefficient for a threaded elbow. We're also told that it's copper pipe. Now if you look up the loss coefficient for threaded elbows, you get 1.5. So our KL for the threaded elbows is 4 times 1.5, which gives us 6. We also have a loss coefficient associated with this open glow valve. If you look this up, you get a KL of 10. Then lastly, we're told that the loss coefficient for our valve at the end is 2.5. It's based on the fluid velocity that we don't know. So now we have the loss coefficients for our pipe network and can calculate the sum of the minor loss coefficients. So the sum was equal to 18.5. So let's start plugging in numbers and simplifying the energy equation. So when I plug in all the values for the equation, I get the following. And now I can start simplifying each component of this equation. So now we have an equation that we thought was only down to one or two variables, the velocity and the friction factor. But you'll see that we have a velocity at 0.2, a velocity at 0.1, and then these undefined velocities. Now our undefined velocities are losses for our pipe network. And so really, we're evaluating the velocity through our pipe network, which is the same as at 0.1. And the velocity at 0.2 is our exit velocity, which is slightly different because it's a smaller diameter. So in simplifying this equation, the other thing we want to do is substitute our velocity at 0.1 into our velocity at 0.2 here. And so using continuity, we know that the flow rate at both points has to be the same, which means that V1A1 is equal to V2A2. So now we could get an expression for V2 squared. That's just going to be equal to V1 times A1 over A2 squared. So knowing our area at 0.1 and our area at 0.2, we can get a relationship for this and plug in for V2. And I get 3.16 V1 squared. So now plugging this in here and simplifying our equation. Now we have our equation where we can determine a friction factor and our velocity, plug it in to satisfy what we know here. Plus we have our Reynolds number equation up top where we said the Reynolds number was equal to 6,906 times our velocity. So the only thing left now is an equation to calculate our friction factor. Now one way to do this is using the Moody diagram. And if you did it this way, you'd be guessing and reading and guessing and reading until you get it right. A more analytically accurate method, maybe in this case, is to use what's known as the Kohlberg equation. Now this is the Kohlberg formula, but as you can see, this also requires an iterative approach since we have the friction factor F on both sides of the equation. Another one which doesn't is known as the Halen equation, and that's what we're going to use here. So you have your choice of going about it, but we have our three relationships. We have our first equation, which is based on our energy balance. We have our second equation, which is based on a relationship for our dimensionless parameter, the Reynolds number. And that's used here in our Halen equation to solve for our friction factor. And I'm going to put all three of these into Excel and use GoalSeek to make our life much easier. For GoalSeek to work properly, we're going to have to rewrite this equation in terms of F. So now we have an equation F equals based on the velocity. And so by guessing a velocity, we could calculate F and the Reynolds number, plug these into our Halen equation, and as long as it matches up, we've guessed the correct velocity. But Excel and GoalSeek will do that for us. So I have Excel open here on the right side just to show you how I set this up. Epsilon, our surface roughness, is something that we need in both equations and the Moody diagram, and that's something we would look up for copper piping. In this case, it's 5 times 10 to the minus 6 feet. So I have that in our equation sheet, plus I'm guessing a velocity of 5 feet per second, so I'm just starting there and using it as a reference. Now this energy F is my equation at the bottom to calculate the friction factor based on the velocity. I also have the Reynolds number, which is 6906 times the velocity. Now both of these go into the Halen equation. And the Halen equation I have marked as 3 on my sheet. You see I have it typed up here in our Excel equation bar, and I've brought that negative 1 over square root of our friction factor onto the right side. So all this should equal 0. So now what I do is the what if analysis, and I do goal seek. And I want to set this value to 0 because it should be satisfied by changing the velocity. When I do this, I find that my velocity is 9.36 feet per second. So we're almost there. So we found V1. We wanted to solve for Q. So Q is just going to equal V1 times A1. This gives me a flow rate of 0.051 feet cubed per second. Now, that does seem really low, except we are looking for it in terms of gallons per minute. So multiply by 60 seconds and use the conversion from feet cubed to gallons, and I get 22.9 gallons per minute, which seems like a fairly high flow rate. Hopefully this gives you an idea on how to use the iterative approach in pipe problems to solve for things that we don't necessarily have. In this case, we didn't have the velocity and needed it, so we had to guess and check till we got our equations to work out.